when fighting back against narcissistic abuse, I don't think it's realistic to expect you to come out the same way that you went into battle. So somebody kindly suggested to me that I had achieved an outcome in the sense that I was a success story. And I would say that for the most part, I have managed to retrieve all the little bits of myself and put them back together again. But there are also some differences, and there are parts that are still not quite right, including my digestion, and including to some extent my mentality. In fact, when I made that video yesterday about my father's narcissistic injury, I went to bed that night with quite a lot of expectation that the spirits or the impersonal forces that dominate our mental realities would torment me for that. And I was surprised to find that they did not. So that has been the first time that I've spoken a very deep level truth and haven't had that flow back where I've been tormented for speaking what I know. And I do put that down to a feeling that I now have that I am among friends, at least with regard to many of the YouTubers that are able to understand things in a very deep way. But let's not assume that we end up in the same way, or we somehow manage to redeem ourselves and pull ourselves together completely. Because that is something that takes such a long time. I remember when I was 28, I think, and I was lying on the bed thinking, like, my health is ruined from this narcissistic abuse. I didn't use that term at the time, but I understood that it had been immoral, unethical, and atrocious. And I thought, well, but I'm still young. I can still recover from this. I'm really lucky. How long has it taken? I am now 47. And it has improved. Everything has definitely improved. But it has taken its time to get there. It has taken a hell of a lot of time, and more recently I began to experience these strange states of mind when I was sleeping. And I do believe that it's because my, in a way, my age is catching up with me. I postulate that I am a perimenopausal. And that means it's a little bit like driving a car without shock absorbers. One does need to be careful what one eats, what one mentally consumes, and so on. But I was surprised by my mental toughness last night. I was able to understand that, yes, it was just narcissistic abuse. I am not guilty for what happened to me when I was chased down all those supermarket aisles. And I had a good night's sleep, and that hasn't happened recently. That hasn't happened when I've dwelt on something negative or made public something negative. I've always felt that there was some flow back or comeuppance for speaking out. My guilty conscience has always attacked me inwardly when I was least able to resist its control, when I was half asleep and very tired. So basically what I'm saying is that fighting against narcissistic abuse is equivalent to being in a state of war. It's not physical warfare necessarily, but it is extreme psychological warfare. And when I was back in my youth in the late 90s, 96, 97, around that time, very naive, very conservative, I suddenly knew that in this workplace, I was under attack. I suddenly knew that an undeclared state of war had transpired. And I don't mean that I had declared any war or undeclared it, but the people around me were, in fact, brutally hostile without stating that they were, and they wanted to use me for all sorts of means to cover up their own inadequacies, both psychological and professional. So when I suddenly knew that, I put myself on a war footing, and what that meant is that I suddenly became prepared to fight ruthlessly. Here's what I did. I suddenly knew. Don't ask me how. There was suddenly an X-ray perspective that I hadn't had before when I moved from red-hot anger to white-hot. Suddenly I knew all sorts of things that I was unable to know previously. And one of the things I knew was that there was a workplace spy ring. So I thought, okay, how do I foil that? And my basic solution was to contradict myself. Of course, when one is under pressure, one is often very much inclined to the emotional confessional mode, where one says, oh, I just feel this, I just feel that. And I still had the need to express what I just felt, because I've never in my adult life been given that space to say what I just felt. It wasn't part of my right-wing culture or my family background to be able to express things like that. So in the workplace, I was doing it, I guess one might say, regrettably. But I thought, okay, well, that's what I've been doing. That was really not that good at all. So what I'll do now is whenever I feel a need to emotionally confess, I will contradict myself. And so I did. So realizing that there was a spy network, I would speak like this. Well, you know, I'm really frustrated with the organization here. It's like the management is really inept, and they keep making me take responsibility for things that I haven't even done. And I feel really hurt, and I just can't believe it. I feel in a lot of pain because of what's happening. So I would confess the truth, and then I would add this. But on the other hand, isn't it great to be working here, and isn't the management really good and efficient? I think it's doing the right thing after all. I think it has our best interests at heart, and we should embrace it totally with everything in our being. So I would directly contradict myself. And I knew that I was speaking to a spy by that point, and so I misfed her information. I still got the chance to confess my deeper feelings and get that off my chest, but I also contradicted it so that it annihilated its original meaning. and became a contradictory meaning. And then what was she going to do? I thought, well, she's going to take both meanings to the boss. She's going to say, well, Jennifer thinks she's really in pain because of you. You know, you're abusing her, taking advantage, making her the fall guy for something she hasn't done. On the other hand, she thinks you're doing a really great job, and she couldn't imagine you doing a better one. And she congratulates you and hopes that we can have a long relationship together. And I thought to myself, well, whatever happens, however she tries to convey that, she's going to be considered untrustworthy because if you contradict yourself, even in relaying a message, either you're not very bright or you're sabotaging or you're basically not worthy of being a fully functional spy anymore. And this is going to undermine and sabotage the spy network. So I did that. I contradicted myself as often as I could remember to do so. And the other thing I did was I acted like a retreating army that had been effectively defeated, because my health was appalling by that stage. My digestive system had collapsed by that stage. And so I thought, well, what do they want that they could use that is part of me? And I destroyed it, as a retreating enemy does. They may destroy ammunition, they may destroy towns, anything that the enemy could take hold of and value. So I began destroying things. I began destroying the sense of my own predictability, of course. I began making it seem that I could be anything, that I didn't have the consistent temperament of somebody who was conventional and predictable and could be easily anticipated and easily controlled. So I began to destroy things like my respect for, at the time, you know, provisionally, I destroyed my respect for truth, for authority, for consistency, and I just continued to make myself unreadable and unlikable, in the sense of, you don't want this person to be giving you anything because it might be something bad. So I constantly retreated, and I constantly removed any traces of myself, as I did. And I basically destroyed who I had been before. And I did that under extreme duress, under the sense that if I didn't do that, I might not survive. My health was getting really bad. My physical health was awful. My psychological health was going to follow. I didn't want to become mad. I didn't want to become a basket case. So I sacrificed things like a lizard sacrifices its tail. I said, here's the tail, flip, flop, flip, flop. And it kept them occupied. Here's the contradiction. Jennifer likes and hates you. Flip, flop, flip, flop. And then I retreated. And it was a tough situation. And, you know, because I had been set back by the migrant experience and my father's hostility, obviously it was not easy for me to recover from. And obviously, I had to take extreme measures to even get where I am today. I had to have an extreme mindset where I sacrificed what I had previously desired to have out of life. In terms of a career, in terms of positive appraisal by others, and I just cut it off and said, well, I don't actually need that. What I need is my mental and physical health. And I became ruthless with regard to protecting those aspects of my being and sacrificing those other things that were less important and less necessary. And so here I am today. I have a very good relationship with an American man who came over here to meet me, and we got married in the year 2000. I have a really strong understanding of myself, a good grounding in philosophy and psychology. I've written books that nobody dares to read as yet, because I think they really are too psychologically true, and to that extent perhaps too grueling for the majority. But they're out there and they may have historical import. And so in many ways I am actually successful. I did manage to get a PhD as well, even though I never really fully recovered from the narcissistic abuse. I put myself in a PhD system and came out trumps. So there's a lot to be grateful for. And at the same time, there's still a lot that I probably should try to work through and recover from, because until recently, I've had these states of torment when I go to sleep. And that's a sign that there's still an injury that is needing some repair. But I believe, as I say, I've already started to repair that, and even the fact that I experienced nothing when I acknowledged my father's narcissistic injury and how that occurred in the recent video is a very positive sign, and everything may turn out very well in the end. But when you go to war, and you do have to go to war, don't ever expect a quick or miraculous recovery, because that it just isn't realistic.